So what we're not going to do is we're not going to review each one of the procedures. And the reason for that is you guys are already current in your procedures because how many times a year do you have to review them?
Six.
So six times a year. You are by far the most current on emergency procedure review than just about any other federation in the world. We're trying to emulate what you're doing in the United States, and we actually have a meeting in a week and a half, our next board meeting. We're going to try to get the USPA instructor reviews to be more in line with what you guys are doing, because the most important thing with emergency procedures is that we continually review them. There's a process of loss of memory that occurs when we stop looking at things. When you look at something on day one, you have hopefully 100% retention of it. But if you don't look at it after 30 days, you can potentially lose up to 90% of the information that you knew on the beginning of that 30-day period. So the only way for us to continue to keep current on these procedures is to continue to expose ourselves to them. So I applaud you guys for doing that every 2 months. It's something that the rest of the world should be doing. And you are starting off in a better position than most other places in the world by having that criteria in place. So because of that, we're not going to go over each line item procedure. You have that information already. But what I want to do is give you some things to think about, some ideas that might help you be in a better position to be able to react to those procedures and react to the situations that you might find yourselves faced with. I think it was Noel, did you mention somebody wrote an incident report and said they needed to drink more tea? Okay. It's actually true. It's actually a valid point. There's a Brazilian tandem instructor who was in the United States, and he spent about 2 years working on a PhD thesis. So he's a smart guy, learning to become a doctor. And he spent 2 years giving tandem instructors jigsaw puzzles and things like that throughout the course of their workday. And would you believe that adequately hydrated tandem instructors had better recall of their emergency procedures than dehydrated instructors? Instructors that were well-fed had a better recall of the emergency procedures than those that were hungry. Instructors that were spending all day in the sun had less recall than those that got to sit in air conditioning every 20, 30 minutes in between loads. So the physical abuse that we put our bodies through throughout the course of the day, whether it's dehydration, whether it's hunger, electrolytes loss, being out in the sun, all of these UV degradation, whatever you want to call it, all these physical components drastically affect our ability to manage cognitive functions, to make good decisions. So if you were going to be presented with an accident scenario or an incident that required your emergency procedure knowledge, you're better prepared for it Friday morning at 9 a.m., fresh and ready to go, than you are sunset on Sunday evening after having made 40 tandems out of a 182 all weekend. So be good to yourselves. If you're any drop zone owners in here, be good to your staff. You should have snack bars around. You should have tea, or we have Gatorade in the United States. I don't know if you guys have some other electrolyte solutions here that you guys drink. But you should be hydrated. You should be fed. You should be out of the sun as much as possible in between your loads, because all of these factors actually affect your ability to recall the very information that you're reviewing. Because when you're reviewing that information, you're not reviewing it in the middle of a busy Saturday afternoon when you're hot and sweaty and tired. You're probably reviewing it on a Friday night or a Monday morning or some other point in time where you're not in a mentally taxing scenario. So I heard the thing about the tea this morning, and I said, you know what, I'm going to let them know that that's actually a good thing. Hydration, food, electrolytes, and lack of fatigue, those are all things that are going to increase your probability of successfully handling an emergency procedure that you're faced with. The incident that we dealt with in Massachusetts in Cape Cod 2 years ago, the fatality that was caused by the horseshoe malfunction that was not handled correctly. The instructor had been working a long season. It was end of August, a long weekend. It was hot, working out of a 182. And just in random chatter on the aircraft earlier that day, said, wow, I'm really tired. It's been a long weekend. The 14th tandem of the day, tired, dehydrated, hungry. All of these potential factors lead into our ability to make a decision. And bear in mind, when we make these decisions, they're typically life and death. And they're typically happening with about 45 to 50 seconds left before we hit the ground. So we're under a bit of stress to begin with. It's not like we're here in an air-conditioned room trying to determine the best course of outcome of an incident and being able to groupthink the solution. We're up there all by ourselves. At that point, it's us, and we're the only ones there to handle that situation. So with that as my baseline for this, I just kind of want to go over with you some of the important factors of emergency procedures. We're going to start by looking at the statistics of emergency procedures, because that's very important. The complexity of the Sigma Tandem system, our confidence of knowledge, the importance of that, the difference between federation procedures and manufacturer procedures. We're going to talk about completing your procedures. We're going to emphasize the fact that the skyhook is not a save-all and why. We're going to talk about with great power, any Spider-Man fans here, with great power comes what? Great responsibility. It's a trick question. Stan Lee actually said it, not Spider-Man. But it's very important. The hand cam effect, we're going to talk about the hand cam effect of emergency procedures and offer some conclusions and some allow for questions. So the statistics of what we're doing and why this is so important. Any of you guys doing tandems back in the 1980s with the old vector systems, the old strong systems? The malfunction rate back then was 1 in 100 to 1 in 200. Bill Booth likes to say that in the first few years of tandems, the main parachute's sole purpose was to slow you down enough so the reserve parachute wouldn't blow up. main parachutes, the old high lifters from 1983 and 84, the first 100 or so tandems without drogues, they would malfunction almost every jump. Then the manufacturer started to figure out some of the mechanical components, things that would work better than others. But in the early days, malfunctions were one in every 200 jumps or so. If a tandem instructor with 1,000 tandems would have five or more malfunctions. Today, however, because we've learned how to build better components using better materials, better quality control testing, the average malfunction on a Sigma where we have properly maintained equipment being used in the manner it was intended to be used in, it's about 1 in 2,000. It's a pretty impressive number. In giving this presentation last year at PIA, I asked, is there anybody in the room with over 10,000 tandem jumps? And a gentleman raises his hand in the back, and I said, congratulations, how many emergency procedures have you had to deal with in that 10,000 jumps? And very proudly, and justifiably so, he said, one. He's only had one malfunction in 10,000 skydives, and that is awesome. To a certain extent. What's the problem? He's only had to deal with his emergency procedure tree once in a decade. How current is he with his emergency procedures? If I've only done something once in 10 years, am I really that current with it? Probably not. So that's the downside, is that we've built gear that is malfunctioning 10% of what it used to malfunction back in the 80s and 90s, so we're not being exposed to our emergency procedures. Those of you doing tandems in the 80s were super current on emergency procedures because you had to use them every weekend. You went through the entire tree, you got everything. You got to start from A to Z, you got all of them during your career. Today, not so much. And to make matters worse, most people have a perception that the emergency procedure they're going to deal with is a tension knot. They're going to deal with a line over. Very mild malfunctions. Very simple procedures. Initiate your breakaway procedures. But what's getting us today isn't tension knots. Nobody's dying from tension knots. Nobody's dying from line overs. What's getting us today are the outlier emergencies, the ones that happen once a decade, once every 5 years. The lottery is off that day for that one person, and they get the bad hand and have to deal with a malfunction that they haven't looked at or been prepared for 5 years. So that's why I want to take this moment of pause for us to just recognize that emergency procedures are varied. It's a bell curve just like anything else. Most of them are tension knots and line overs, but there's a lot of outlier things that we could present ourselves with, and we just need to be prepared for them and be in the best possible position to be able to handle them if and when we find them. And in order to do that, we have to have respect for our tandem systems. I know you guys have multiple ones in the country, so I'd ask you to do your own research afterwards on the other systems. I'm going to use Sigma as my example. There's a false sense of security that if you jump a Sigma, you're better or safer than anybody else in the field. And we appreciate that sentimentality. But the reality is, as advanced as this system may be, and it is, Bill Booth will tell you, this is the sum and corporation of his entire career in skydiving. Everything he's learned over the 40 years plus of skydiving and inventing and building, he's put into this. But no matter how advanced the system might be, it is only as safe, it is only as good as what? The mind that's operating it. Okay? If we treat it like a loaded gun and start twirling it around, eventually it's going to go off and we're going to have an accident. Or if we treat it with the respect that it deserves and we understand that it is a very complex system that requires a very complex mind to operate. And I offer for your consideration evidence of that. If you look at our emergency procedure tree, it's as much of a shrub as it is a tree. It goes out laterally about as far as it goes down vertically. There's a lot of things that can potentially go wrong through packing malfunctions, through instructor error, all the different possible problems. And this was in 2001. This is when a bunch of engineers sat around and went, what can go wrong with this system based on how we operate it? And this is what they came up with. Today, we have this. We have this, and we have this. It's now a three-page tree, okay? We've now gone ahead and we've managed to put into a flowchart emergency procedure tree 3 pages of possible negative outcomes in tandem skydiving, all the things that can go wrong in tandem that can be corrected using this system, but it needs the mind to be able to be working in concert with the system to be able to do it. Unfortunately, the reality is a lot of instructors in the field get away with bad behaviors, bad performance, lack of knowledge, because they can go 5 years or 6 years without a malfunction. And when they do get that malfunction, it's probably a tension knot, which even the most basic of tandem instructor can wing it and pull their cutaway handle and pull the reserve handle and probably survive, right? But those aren't the ones that are getting us. It's the outlier incidents. It's all these things outside of the tension knot and outside of the line over that we have to prepare ourselves for. With a complex system requires a complex mind to operate it. We also have a complexity of procedures. Being a tandem instructor is an awesome responsibility. There's so many things that can happen throughout the course of a single skydive that we have to be prepared to handle all of them quickly, efficiently, and most importantly, correctly. Aircraft procedures. We have a clearly laid out aircraft procedure chart in our manual, 3 different altitudes from ground level to 1500, 1500 to 4000 feet and 4000 and above. We have specific procedures for both flat and gliding malfunctions as well as catastrophic malfunctions. I think I asked earlier today, anybody in this room been in an aircraft that's had a mechanical problem? For those of you that haven't raised your hand, stick in the sport long enough, and you will. The more we do, the more skydives we make, the more volume of production, the greater the likelihood is that we're going to be in an aircraft incident at some point in our career. I've been in one. I don't want to be in any more of them. It's not a fun place to be in. But when you're in them and you have the procedures in your head on how to react to them, you drastically increase your probability of surviving both yourself and your student. We then have our exit procedures. We already covered that in the last presentation, all the things that we demand of ourselves for exits to prevent problems. But there's a lot of things that can go wrong on exit. You can dislodge the pin if you're not careful. You can have a horseshoe malfunction. I mentioned that earlier this morning. Free fall procedures. What happens in free fall when our students grab our arms? How do we free our arms? Things like that. Drogue fall procedures. What can still happen to us in drogue fall? Deployment issues. How do we deal with deployment malfunctions? Canopy procedures. What happens when we have that line over? How do we deal with it? Landing procedures. How do we deal with broken toggles and things like that? So there's procedures for all these different types of possible outcomes. It's not just skydive. It's not just exit and parachute. There's all these different areas we have to be well-versed in and educated in. So I would offer that to you guys as a consideration that, again, tandem skydiving is the most complex form of skydiving we have, and there's so many different things that can go wrong in different areas that we have to be strong in all of those areas, not just here, not just there, not just there. That entire spectrum we have to have knowledge of. And not only do we have to have knowledge of all these areas, we have to be confident in our ability to recall that information. The three most critical words in emergency procedure review, are you sure? I asked you this morning about the camera flyer stuck in the drogue bridle. You gave me the correct answer right off the bat, which was awesome. But then I asked to the room, are you sure? And not every head nodded up and down, yes. Maybe some people were still waking up, I don't know. Maybe some of you guys were confident in it, but not sure of it. when we're not sure of the procedure, it leads to hesitation. We need to make sure that we have a confidence level that when we're presented with something, what's the procedure? And you give it back to me. And it happens immediately. That way, we're dealing with it when it happens, not thinking it over. On the ground, we can sit and think all day long. But up there, we have about 25, 30 second window to manage a process. So we don't have a lot of time to think. When we fail to act, and we are subject to indecision, we burn altitude. It lowers the altitude of response. The lower the altitude of response, the lower the probability of a successful outcome. Indecision can lead to incorrect emergency procedures. If we're not sure and we force ourselves to guess, it could be the incorrect procedure. This happens at both the instructor level and the examiner level. I've queried current examiners that same question that I asked you. I've gotten varied responses, including, I would fire the reserve. Imagine a tandem instructor activating his reserve with his videographer still stuck in tow. Okay, and that's from an active current examiner. This was years ago, but it did happen. The problem with that is the answers are here in the manual, in the book. These are people that were trained to look at that information and knew it when they took their course, but they hadn't reviewed it in years, and they forgot. So it doesn't matter whether you're a brand new instructor or whether you're the examiner trainer. Anywhere in that spectrum, you have the potential to forget this information unless you continue to review it. And so at the end of the day, when I ask, are you sure, the last question I asked, and I think I asked it this morning, would you bet your rating on it? And a number of people over the years have bet their ratings on these questions and have lost them, meaning they got the answer wrong. But we're really not betting our rating when we're betting that question. What we're really betting is with our lives, the lives of ourselves and the lives of our students. So if anyone ever asks you an emergency procedure, you give the procedure, you should be willing to bet your rating on it, because ultimately you're betting your life on it. And if you don't have that confidence, here it's okay. But make sure before you put that rig on your back the next time that you do have that confidence, that you do go back and review that information and make sure it's clear and current before you put the rig on. Now, the United States and Canada and a handful of other countries just use our UPT program, our UPT manual, our UPT procedures, because it's already prepackaged, it's pre-made, and we make our decisions based on the predominant information presented to us around the world. But there are a number of federations, Australia, New Zealand, BPA, a number of different international federations that have their own procedures, own procedure tree. I offer you this because occasionally the procedures might vary. One federation might take Sigma, Strong, Next, and all the other manufacturers and put them all into one procedure tree. That may or may not be correct. There are some deviations between our procedures and Strong's and Next and the other ones. And the reason there might be deviations is because we built the gear different. There might be different responses to different situations. I'm not here to tell you one is better than the other or more correct than the other. I can tell you we're responsible for one based on what we know. But you might have a valid reason why you feel something in your federation procedure might deviate from the manufacturer. As long as you understand why we do what we do what you do, and where that deviation is, you will be prepared to handle that situation. So I'm not here to tell you your federation procedures must mirror ours, but what I am here to offer you is that it's probably a good idea to compare them side by side, and any deviations that you have, identify them and understand why there's a deviation. It could have been someone 20 years ago said, I don't like Ted or I don't like Bill, so I'm not doing that. It could have been that benign, you know? Or it could have been, we've had enough people experience this situation that we understand why they do that. We're gonna choose to do something differently. But there are federation and manufacturer differences out there, and you might travel to a foreign country. A lot of you guys will go to New Zealand. Just be aware of what the procedures are, how they vary, because you have to know why. And because some federations, at least one of them I know of, just put them all together, and some of the things we ask you to do on our system may not be the right thing for another tandem system. So address the differences and be knowledgeable of them. Okay. Oftentimes when emergency procedures are conducted, they're abbreviated. We get into a deployment emergency procedure, We stop flying our body because we're worried about what's going on above us. A bag lock is a perfect example. When a bag lock occurs, it's a high-speed malfunction that can be made worse when you stop flying your body. And what happens is the instructors will look up, see a bag lock, and immediately they will panic and they will stop flying their body. Everything will just stop. They will rotate over on their back and they will take a bad situation and make it worse. So if it's, say, a free fall of emergency procedure, if someone grabs your left arm, don't stop flying your body with your right arm and your legs, you know. Maintain your body flight. If it's a breakaway procedure, clear the risers. This is something that we see often from AFF students onward. From our first jump, we're learned to do, taught to do this, right? We're taught to do this. Maybe we clear it, maybe it's two hands, but we're not taught to do this. What am I doing? I'm not stretching my neck. I'm looking to make sure my risers have left. I've cut away. I'm looking to make sure my risers have left. And if they haven't left, what do I need to do? I need to clear them. Every year we have tandem instructors do this and do this. They fire the reserve while they're still attached to their main risers. The cutaway cable has been cleared, but they haven't released the risers yet. Low drag malfunctions like bag locks with the collapsed drogue bridle may or may not clear the risers. There may not be enough drag to pull the risers off your back. Therefore, it is your responsibility to clear your risers. Your responsibility on every breakaway, we should be looking to make sure that our risers have cleared the system before we activate the reserve. And this is silly. I apologize for even having to say this, but it is your responsibility as an instructor to deploy your reserve parachute. Why do I have to say that? Who said skyhook? RSL, skyhook, yes. Unfortunately, as an industry, as a culture, and anybody here over 40? You guys are exempt from this one. To all of you instructors under 40, all you young people, I'm 42 now. It's our newer generation of tandem instructors, unfortunately. Historically, it's been the younger guys and girls that are failing to finish their procedures because they're relying on the RSL, they're relying on the skyhook. Okay, they cut away and they expect the RSL and or the skyhook to finish the job for them, to take over the procedures. And to make matters worse, they usually have a hand cam and they want to film it because they're thinking about 3, 2, 1 Facebook. Oh, I gotta get the view, you know, and that's unfortunate. It's funny, but it's funny here. It's really not funny up there, and it is happening over and over again. Which brings me to a critical point in emergency procedure review. Skyhook is not a save-all, all right? It cannot protect you from everything. First of all, the skyhook only has an opportunity to work when two conditions are met. And I said only has an opportunity to work. The first one is that the RSL lanyard is attached. But it's a Sigma. Why wouldn't the RSL lanyard be attached? You guys tell me. Why would you disconnect the RSL? High wind landing. Should the next person make sure that the RSL is reconnected before they put it on their back? Anybody ever missed anything in a preflight? It could happen to everybody, right? This gets missed all the time in preflights. So if the RSL is not reattached, do you have a skyhook? I guarantee you, every person that's jumped this rig with an RSL unattached did not think they were capable of missing an RSL in a preflight, but it happens. The RSL we can see visually. The other condition that must be met is this red lanyard. This is the skyhook lanyard. It has to be connected to something. What does it have to be connected to? Skyhook. Can anybody tell me if it's been connected? I can't. I can tell you it's probably connected. I know the guy who packed it. But I can't tell you for sure if it's packed and it's in there properly because I can't see it. If we had a lesser rigger, it's possible that they didn't put the red, the cotton thread. They didn't put the thread around the safety, around the skyhook. The red lanyard could move itself off of the hook, and it could free itself. If the red lanyard frees itself from the skyhook, do we have a skyhook? No. Or they could have just forgot to install it altogether. So both of those reasons are reasons why the skyhook would not work. One, I can see the RSL. the other one I can't see. And because I can't see the other one, I never know if I have a sky hook on my back. Therefore, it's my responsibility to ensure correct procedures, whether I have a sky hook or an RSL or not. The high wind day is the most common one. You forget it, you miss it, it's a busy day, it's a turn load, you forgot to rehook the RSL, you cut away expecting the sky hook, and what happens? Nothing. You just fall over on your head because now you're unstable and you panic and fire the reserve between your legs. This is what happens, unfortunately, when people rely on something and miss things in their pre-flight. So if you have an overconfidence in the sky hook, hopefully we've just removed it, because as humans, we're still capable of making mistakes that will affect the sky hook's ability to do its job. Rigging errors potentially, when those we'll never see inside the system. And the RSL disconnections are the massive problem that we face with it. So I asked you earlier, with great power comes great responsibility. It's your responsibility to know your procedures. And again, I applaud you guys. The way the BPA requires you to look every 2 months really puts you ahead of the curve when it comes to emergency procedure retention. So I really won't spend too much time on the knowledge of the procedures because you guys have that. But respecting the equipment, the system is only as good as the people that use it and the people that maintain it, the rigging staff, the packers. Critical to stay current on procedures, because procedures can not just change, they can evolve, there can become more of them. Where did I get this from? We have a new manual. Sigma, there's a new manual this year. I would encourage you guys all to go to our website, uptvector.com, and download it. You can get the new emergency procedure tree along with all the other information. All of our emergency procedures are in a chronological, logical order from aircraft to exit, exit to free fall to drogue fall, drogue fall to deployment, deployment to canopy, and canopy to landing. All in logical order inside the manual. Easy to read, clear and concise. Tandem by itself is a massive responsibility. What could go wrong? Two bodies, a self-induced pilot shoot and tow to slow us down, right? The Sigma is by far the most complex system out there that addresses the most complex variety of problems. The big three issues in the 1980s and 1990s were open container and drogue fall, having a three-ring drogue riser and the main pack tray opens and the bag flops around. That was a dangerous situation to be in. It killed some people early on. Broken risers. A broken RSL riser could be catastrophic if it releases the reserve before you release the non-RSL riser. And then the third major issue in tandem jumping for the first two and a half decades was unstable reserve deployments. You've got this large mass of 400 and 500 pounds spinning around a tension-knotting main canopy. You cut away and you get flung head over heels away from the main canopy and you panic and you fire the reserve. Pilot chute passes through your legs and a bad day is about to present itself to you. Those were the three big issues in tandem jumping. Open container and drogue fall, not possible anymore with the disc system. Okay? The broken RSL riser launching the reserve into a trailing main, not possible with the Collins lanyard system. And I'll preface that by saying anything is technically possible. We could probably find a way to still screw this up as we put it together as humans, but you understand what I'm saying, that the Collins lanyard removes the possibility of the broken riser. And then last but not least, yes, the Skyhook's strength is that the unstable reserve deployment, when this is properly packed, when the RSL is attached, and when it's jettisoning from a main canopy that it's been attached to, it has the greatest likelihood of preventing an unstable reserve deployment. So those three big things have been resolved with the system. But that still doesn't take away the fact that it has to be us operating the system that ultimately keeps us safe, not the system. We don't rely on the Sigma. The Sigma relies on us, okay? It ultimately is only as good as we are when we use it. The hand cam effect. Just because you have a malfunction doesn't mean you shouldn't never miss the shot. I make this shit look good. Okay? 3, 2, 1, Facebook. This is out there. This is fish jumping into the boat. This is social media. And I was kidding about that. If you're over 40, you know, you're admonished from this, but it's the younger generations, the 20-somethings, the millennials, I've always wanted to use that term, the millennials, that everything is social media, Instagram, Facebook, all that stuff. If you have a hand cam, you can never lose focus of the fact we're tandem instructors first, we're tandem instructors second, we're tandem instructors third, and maybe 7 or 8 more episodes down the line, the hand cam comes into play, we become videographers. But once we become involved in emergency procedure, the hand cam has to go away, 100%, completely, gone. Because once we start focusing on the hand cam, what are we not focusing on? The job that we have to do. Now, as much as I like to pick on this guy for doing this, just because you have a malfunction doesn't mean you should miss the shot. I make this shit look good. I will give him credit where credit is due. At least he pulled the reserve handle. I cannot emphasize this enough. If it wasn't so real and so serious, it wouldn't be funny that instructors have stopped pulling their reserve handles on breakaways because they have a skyhook attached. It's mind-blowing. And if you throw a hand cam on, forget it. You're not going to get a red reserve handle out ever. That's going to sit there for the rest of its life because they want to catch that shot and catch that skyhook deployment and put it on their Facebook page and put it on their Vimeo channels. If that is your mentality, it's time to find another career. We must be pulling all of our handles that we're trained to do. Nowhere in our manual and nowhere in the BPA manual does it say film your skyhook deployment. Okay, we're clear on that. And that will never appear there. So just a reminder, pull all of your handles, never rely on the skyhook, and just because you have a hand cam, do not allow it to prevent you from performing your functions as an instructor. We don't care if everything is in frame, we care that all the handles are pulled. We don't rely on the RSL, we pull all our handles. We still clear our risers visually and physically if needed. We must manually activate the reserve and continue to always fly our body. So, in conclusion, you guys already do a fantastic job on educating yourselves on emergency procedures. Again, you have my respect, and I wish more countries would do what you guys are doing. Once a year is definitely not enough. Every 2 months is amazing. For our new instructors, as of 2 years ago, if you go through our factory course, we make you sign a pledge, if you will, a contract that you will review your procedures every month. We want active people that are jumping year-round to look at them every month so that they keep them in their consciousness. You have to be confident. You have to be sure in what you're doing. The best way to do that is to have staff meetings. Talk about it amongst yourselves. You might not all agree on the same thing, and that's okay. There are emergency procedures where 1 + 1 = 2. For example, you have a line over you cannot clear. You cannot land the canopy. What must you do? Cut away, make sure the risers are cleared, and activate the reserve. That is a clear 1 + 1 = 2. There's also going to be procedures out there that 1 + 1 might equal red. It doesn't actually have a clear line from one to the other. For example, you have thrown the drogue. You look back, the drogue is not behind you. It's not inflated. So we reach back to check our pocket, and it's been extracted from our pocket. Where is it? It's probably in our burble, right? So what do? We roll over on our right shoulder, and hopefully that clear air would clear it. We look back, it's still not there. We roll over our left shoulder. We look back, it's still not there. So we've done all the things we could logically do, and there's still no drogue behind us. Well, what do? We have no main parachute. We've got nothing to land. Fire the reserve, right? Or is that what we do? Who fires a reserve with a drogue bridle on your back, right? It's not a clean answer. It's not a clear 1 + 1 = 2. There is a solution. We have to put a parachute over our head. And if there is no main parachute over our head, we must put a reserve over our head, even if there's a drogue bridle trapped somewhere there in our burble. But not everybody's going to like that answer because it's not clean. It's not a clear, this will separate from that. So I just offer you that for your consideration, that some things are going to make clear, perfect sense. Others may not. But as long as we are having staff meetings and talking to each other and understand that from our perspective as a manufacturer, we just simply have the most amount of input from the field. So when we make decisions in our emergency procedure tree, make decisions for our malfunction list, while some of them are clear, 1 + 1 = 2, some of them might not be, and you could argue doing one of a number of things, cutaway or not cutaway. We have the best case scenarios and the best chance outcomes based on the large volume of percentages of numbers that we see in the field when these things happen correctly. So that's where we get our information from, and it helps us draft our procedures. At the end of the day, don't let the fact you have the Ferrari of tandem systems on your back, don't let the fact, how's that for marketing? Don't let the fact that you have years of knowledge in your head of emergency procedures and standard procedures and go 10 years without a malfunction, don't let any of that ever lull you into a false sense of security that tandem skydiving is not the most dangerous type of skydiving we ever do, because it is. Tandem will always be the most dangerous type of skydiving out there. Two bodies, one system, a drogue in tow to slow us down. So many things can go wrong if we're not prepared for them. So don't ever lose that focus, and don't let a 5-year span without a malfunction lull you into an overconfidence in yourself or in your equipment, because that next malfunction is always just around the corner. So respect it, respect the dangers of what we do. We've given you the best of Bill Booth's history and his education and his engineering background. We've given you the best of what we can with our emergency procedures and our standard operating procedures, but at the end of the day, it all relies on you. It's your shoulders. If you choose to accept it with that great responsibility, please act so accordingly, and don't ever forget how serious it is what we do. So when it comes to emergency procedures, be confident. It's your job to know. And yeah, that was actually good. We got 5 minutes before the 3:30. That's all I've got. Do you guys have any questions about emergency procedures or about any specific incidents? We could probably run that now before we get prepped up for Kenneth's section. Anything we can answer? Any questions? No? Okay. Well, thank you guys for the time. I hope that was good.